Good afternoon. All mainland states and territories are now in Labor hands after the trouncing of the Perrottet coalition government in New South Wales. And the Prime Minister has embraced the moment as he tries to steer the nation towards the voice referendum. More from our political editor, Charles Croucher.
It is another day of soul searching for the Liberal Party, this time here in New South Wales, following the election result last night. Labor claiming power, ending a run of Liberal premiers, and meaning that Scott Morrison's miracle in 2019 was the last time the Liberal Party won an election at federal or state level on the mainland. Here is part of what the new premier said last night.
Friends, the people of New South Wales voted to put in a government that would put people at the heart of all decision making, and we will not let them down.
Anthony Albanese was on stage to introduce Chris Minns. He is also on a roll in already eyeing the voice referendum that is coming up later this year. He's Attorney General defending the wording that was released by the government regarding the change that we made to the Constitution. There has been criticism, particularly from Peter Dutton, about potential High Court challenges. Mark Dreyfus says that is not a concern.
The Australian people are going to be the arbiter of this change to the Constitution. I can assure Australians that this amendment to our Constitution is constitutionally sound.
That is a vote for later in the year. The more pressing issue, particularly for the Liberal Party, is steadying that ship. They can do that this weekend at the Aston by-election in Melbourne.
Meanwhile, it was a historic day in South Australia. Crowds there flocking to Parliament House to witness a state-based voice to Parliament become law. Ollie Haig has more.
Well, thousands have braved the rain, gathering outside South Australia's Parliament in the heart of Adelaide to witness history.
And this was that moment, a special Sunday sitting broadcast on screens to crowds outside as legislation passed, making SA the first state in the country to establish a First Nations voice to Parliament.
The ayes have it. The ayes have it.
The ayes have it. What a moment.
It's been a long time coming, but it's really exciting that we're doing it in South Australia first.
I'm just excited and relieved growing up in the system.
The Australian Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islands flags cascading down North Terrace as South Australians celebrated the momentous day.
That Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people have invited us to walk with them on. Today in South Australia, we have accepted that invitation.
Some protesters nearby doing little to dampen the mood.
I think it's a sense of optimism for the future.
Many in the crowd hoping it will inspire Australians to vote yes in the looming national referendum.
I'm sure we'll be a big yes state for the voice and the referendum later in the year.
It's expected the local voice to Parliament will be functional by the end of the year.
Victoria's Premier will fly to China tomorrow night for a four-day trade mission. Shubha Krishnan explains.
He'll be the first Australian leader to visit China since the pandemic, and Daniel Andrews says it'll be all about education and tourism. Tapping into the highly lucrative multi-billion dollar market, top of the agenda as the Premier prepares to jet off to Beijing for a four-day trade blitz.
We want their students to come here, and if they do, they'll be part of a respectful community.
No stranger to the superpower, it'll be his seventh visit, making the voyage every year since he came into office until the pandemic.
Our partnership with China is incredibly important for our income, for our industry, for investment, for jobs, and for the strongest possible future.
But it's the past that still haunts Daniel Andrews. In 2019, he blindsided Canberra by signing up to China's controversial Belt and Road Initiative, deemed against Australia's national interest. It was later torn up by Scott Morrison.
That matter was resolved by the federal parliament, so that matter's in the past. This trip is all about the future.
The Premier confirming he would not be taking media on the trip. The state opposition, though, slamming that decision, citing a lack of transparency.
I think all Victorians would want to know who Daniel Andrews is meeting, what's the intention of the trip, and what's the benefit to Victorians. That needs to be the focus.
Daniel Andrews will leave for China tomorrow night.
The driver of a stolen car remains at large after a crash in Melbourne's north, which claimed the life of a 19-year-old woman. Elizabeth Moss reports.
A young couple were returning home at about 10 past one this morning. They were pulling out onto the main road when they were ploughed into by a stolen Kia. Each car was sent hurtling across the road with debris strewn across several lanes.
A couple of bangs and a couple of screeches.
Inside the Kia, two young women trapped. Sadly, the 19-year-old couldn't be saved.
It's shattering, like, to think it happens right next to your place. Could happen to you, could happen to anyone.
The driver of the stolen Kia she was in fled the scene.
I don't know why you would ever be involved in a motor vehicle accident or attend a scene where someone seriously hurt or injured, or why you would not hang around and give that person some help.
The other female passenger was taken to the Alfred, where she's in a stable condition, while the couple in the Mercedes SUV was taken to hospital. They're both also in stable conditions. Detectives from the Major Collision Investigation Unit searched the stolen car today, retrieving mobile phones and a baseball cap. They're still trying to piece together exactly what happened in the moments leading up to the collision. But they want the driver of the Kia to hand themselves in.
I don't know why they didn't ring a friend, ring the police, knock on a neighbour's door. So I want to know. I want them to come forward and tell us what happened.
Detectives have also been collecting CCTV from the businesses on the other side of the road to see if that can help piece together exactly how this deadly collision happened.
Homicide detectives are investigating after an unknown man who was dumped at a Melbourne hospital with life-threatening injuries died at the scene. Authorities were called to Casey Hospital at Berwick around 7:30 a.m, but the man could not be saved. One person has been arrested late this afternoon. Well, tensions have flared in Queensland's far north after police shot dead a man who allegedly charged at officers with a knife. Kate Lamb has the details.
Well, there have been angry scenes west of Cairns in the rural town of Mareeba, where a Love Street home remains a crime scene more than 24 hours after police were called there to reports of a domestic violence incident.
It's alleged that a 27-year-old man was armed with a knife, refusing to allow a female to leave that property.
4 hours of tense negotiations turning fatal when police opened fire as the man allegedly advanced towards officers armed with a weapon around 4:30 yesterday afternoon, his death sparking outrage in the grieving community.
Well, this family needs justice!
Police telling them overnight body-worn camera footage will form part of the investigation that's now being handled by the Ethical Standards Command on behalf of the state coroner and being overseen by the Crime and Corruption Commission.
So the investigation will take as long as it needs to take to ensure that it's independent, transparent, and provides answers for the man's family and for everyone involved in this matter.
Police wouldn't confirm how long that investigation would take and also wouldn't be drawn on whether the alleged weapon has been seized.